right, so let's call this video Introduction to Procedural Due Process. We're going to find out, right, in your studies of constitutional law, that there are two types of due process case. One is procedural and one is substantive. We hold off on substantive due process until Constitutional Law 2. That relates to, what you know, substantive rights, you know, the right of the individual to do certain things without governmental interference. In Common Law 1, we talk about procedural due process, and I'll talk about why in a minute. But I want to start with the text of the Constitution. First of all, note that there are two due process clauses in the Constitution, right? There's one in the Fifth Amendment, and there's one in the 14th Amendment. They both say the same thing, that the government's not allowed to take away your life, liberty, or property without due process of law. Now, why is it so convenient to have two due process clauses? Well, because that means there's no question that both levels of government, right, federal and state, have to follow the rules of due process. When you look at the Bill of Rights, right, the first 10 amendments to the Constitution, the first 8 really are the ones that enumerate certain specific rights. The way the Bill of Rights starts, obviously, is with the First Amendment, and look at the words there, right, that the First Amendment starts with. It starts with the words, Congress shall make no law. So the Bill of Rights, including the Fifth Amendment, clearly applies to the federal government, right? The 14th Amendment, on the other hand, when you read that, says no state shall. Critical differences, right? You know, normal readers would read right past some of these words and not get the significance, right? Congress shall make no law, federal government, no state shall, state government. So again, the Fifth Amendment applies to the federal government, and the 14th applies to states. So you have to check your fact pattern, right? If there's a procedural due process challenge, you have to know which level of government is being challenged, and you have to cite the appropriate amendment, right, and not the wrong one. Okay, now why, you know, in Common Law 1, so, you know, we start with all the different governments, right? Federal judicial, federal legislative, federal executive, state. And then we wind up with sort of this kind of strange, you know, amalgamation of rules. One reason, frankly, is because we have to find somewhere to put it, right? We have to cover state action and procedural due process. But also, we don't want to start Common Law 2 without making sure that we hit some of these really basic principles. So we're going to talk, I'm going to talk for a second about both procedural due process and state action together, but state action will be covered in detail in a later video. Procedural due process is a procedural promise, okay? So to say that the government cannot take away life, liberty, or property without due process, you have to kind of flip that on its head and say, well, okay, if the Constitution says the government can't take away my life, liberty, or property without due process, the strong implication there seems to be that the government can take those things away, right? It can take away my life, it can take away my liberty, and it can take away my property. But it can't do so without due process, right? So as long as it provides due process, right, it can do those things. So procedural due process is not a promise of substantive rights. It is a promise of procedural fairness. Please have that concept, right? make sure you've digested that, right? Because courts say that all the time, right? They say the words fundamental fairness, right? Due process is about fundamental fairness, right? So it's again the due process clause, in the sense that we're talking about it here, is a procedural promise, not a substantive promise. It is not a promise of substantive rights. It is a promise of procedural fairness. Now, the reason we have procedural due process and state action kind of lumped together at the end of this course is that you would have to be a state actor, right, for a due process to apply, right? That's something now that we've got to really, again, hammer home. There is a common misperception, very common misperception, out there among lay people. And since you're a law student now and you're about to be a lawyer, this is something you have to explain to people and make sure that they get it right. A private party, right, cannot violate the Constitution. The audience for the Constitution is the government, right? The Constitution creates and restrains the federal government, right? And it provides other restraints on state government. The Constitution says nothing about what you or I as individual citizens, right, private citizens, should do or not do. Actually, let me correct that. The only part of the Constitution that has anything to do with private conduct anymore is the 13th Amendment, which says slavery or involuntary servitude shall not exist in the United States. That doesn't require state action. It means nobody can engage in that. But leaving that aside, the entire rest of the Constitution addresses itself to the government, and that's it. I remember hearing, this was years and years ago when I was still up in Michigan, about somebody who was accusing Cooley Law School of violating their constitutional due process rights. I can't remember what. It had something to do with being dismissed, obviously, for disciplinary reasons, right, and was going to sue us and was going to claim a constitutional violation, right, of due process rights. And the only thing I thought when I heard that was, I hope that idiot, whoever this is, did not have me for constitutional law, because that would be a mistake of epic proportions, right, to claim in a federal court that a private actor, right, like a private law school, violated your constitutional rights. It cannot happen. Now, we're going to talk later on, there are very rare cases, right, in which courts might say that a private actor is going to be imputed with state action, treated like a state actor, but those are very rare cases. So that's why the link between procedural due process and state action at the end of this course. Procedural due process is something that, you know, the first thing you got to look for, right, before you can claim a procedural due process violation. The first thing you got to look for is there a state actor, right? Is it the federal government, a state government, or a local municipal government, right, that is allegedly violating your client's rights or being unfair? Okay, once you get past that, assuming, right, that you're claiming, right, that it's the government, right, the state or federal government or subdivision of a state that has been unfair in a procedural way, right, to your client. Before we get into the nuts and bolts, you know, the elements of what due process means, you have to show that there's been a deprivation of life, liberty, or property, right? Or that there is a threatened deprivation of life, liberty, or property. Now, life is pretty simple to figure out, right? Taking away somebody's life, that obviously means death penalty. That's kind of a rare case. So in order for you to be entitled to procedural due process, procedural fairness, right, you don't get that unless the government takes away your life, liberty, or property. So what does liberty mean? What does property mean, right? Those are the questions that you have to answer before we get to what process do you get. I'm going to end this video, because I don't want to run long again, with asking you to consider that term due process, right? So you're guaranteed due process, and again, in the next video we'll talk about depriving you of life or liberty or property. But you're entitled to due process when the government takes away one of those things, or threatens to take away, or is trying to take away one of those things. So let me ask you this question. What is due process, right? Well, again, like always, we do the words, right? Well, process means what? I mean, think about that for a minute. You're entitled to process. Process, that means what? Certain steps, right? Procedures, obviously, right? Process, procedure. And then what process, what procedure, what steps are you entitled to, right? What hoops does the government have to jump through, right, before it takes away your life, liberty, or property? Well, that process that is due, D-U-E. What does due mean? D-U-E, right? In the context we're using it, I'm boring my dog apparently. Due in the context that we're using it, right, means, and we occasionally you'll say, use this kind of language in common, right, conversation. Due in this sense means fair, right? Procedures which are due are procedures to which you're entitled, right? And you're entitled to what? You're entitled to fundamental fairness. So here's the problem. That is awfully broad language to be using, right? You're entitled to due process. If we were just to leave it there and say, okay, go ahead and apply that to a case, right? That'd be hopeless. That's the thing with the Constitution, right? The Constitution is very broadly worded and cries out for interpretation. So, There's nothing I can do about this dog. I did a radio interview this morning, by the way, and had her upstairs, and she came charging down the stairs like a torpedo. So I'm mad at her today, but nothing I can do about this. At any rate, due process means fair procedures. You got to put what I always call meat on those bones, right? You've got to come up with some framework for analyzing it. That's why we're going to have a few videos coming up here, right? But there's your fundamentals, right? There has to be, you need a state actor, right, to be entitled to due process, and you have to, the state actor has to have taken away life, liberty, or property. Due process, the term is very broad. We got to figure out what that means. We're going to find out in videos to come. First of all, what are liberty and property interests, right? Number one. Number two, what are the elements of procedural due process, right? What are you, and there are elements. And finally, we'll talk about, right, once we decide what are the basic components of due process, right? How much due process is somebody entitled to? As we'll see in these videos, those are different questions. So enough for this one. In the next one, we will talk about what is life, liberty, and property, because that's the only time due process applies.